إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل دلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، all praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, we laud Him, in Him we seek help, and in Him we seek forgiveness. And we seek the refuge of Allah Ta'ala from the mischiefness of our souls and the wrongdoings of all of our actions and deeds. Whoever Allah guides, no one can lead him astray. And whoever Allah leaves to be left astray, no one will be able to guide them. And I publicly bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship as a deity except Allah. He is alone, He has no partners. And I also bear witness that Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and his messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah with just fear and do not die except as Muslims. O human beings, fear your Lord who created you from one soul and from that one soul its mate, and from the two of them countless men and women spread abroad in multitudes. Keep the family ties that you have among you. Remember the wombs that bore you, for surely Allah is a watcher over you. O you who believe, fear Allah and say that which is correct and true. Allah will repair your deeds for you and forgive you of your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has achieved the greatest of us of successes. As to what follows, surely the best speech is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad, and the worst of all affairs are newly invented matters. For every newly invented matter in this deen is an accursed innovation. Every innovation is a going astray, and every astray is in the hellfire. As we've been talking about for the past few weeks, the subject of khushu' and salah, we've given some examples on how we can produce khushu' in our salah, and we've talked about the hukm or the legal verdict pertaining to khushu', and we've talked about the reward that the people who are khashi'een will receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having this khushu' and their salah, and that reward is al-firdaus. Insha'Allah, we'd like to continue with this topic of al-khushu' fi salah, al-khushu' in the prayers. And we'd like today, insha'Allah, to talk about some of those things that will help us to avoid not having khushu' or that will cancel out or will damage our khushu'. And one of them that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned to us is removing those things in the place where you're going to pray. Removing those things in the area, in the makan, that you're going to pray, so that they won't distract you and disturb you. Sometimes, in fact, in many cases today, we go to the Muslim world, and now even in this country in America, we find masjids being built on other than the sunnah. And we find masjids that when the people build those masjids, if they are not building them to those requirements that the people are asking for, people won't even donate money because they're saying these places don't look like masjids. But in reality, the masjids of old, the masjids from the time of the Sahaba and the time of the Prophet before them or with them, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those masjids did not have the things that the masjids have today. Even in the most sacred places of Islam today, we find masajid being built on other than the sunnah. Even in the most sacred places of the world, we find masjids being built on other than the sunnah. We find masjids with minarets. And minarets are not part of the sunnah. We find masjids with domes. And domes are not part of the sunnah. We find masjids with maharib, mihrabs, the so-called niche where the imam stands. And this is not part of the sunnah. In addition to this, we find masjids with elaborate decorations, with chandeliers. We find masjids with calligraphy, with ayat from the Quran written on the walls, and hadith from our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether they are authentic or unauthentic hadith. We find hadith written on the walls. This, brothers and sisters in Islam, is not a part of the sunnah. In fact, it is in contradiction to the sunnah. In fact, these are innovations in Islam, and every innovation is astray, and every astray is in the hellfire. These things, in addition to being innovations in Islam, we also find them distracting the people from khushu' and thinking about Allah with humility and awe. These verses that they're putting on the walls and the carpets with the different colors and images are things that the Prophet avoided. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was in Aisha's house, she had a qiram in her house. And some of the scholars of Islam say a qiram is either some type of curtain that has images on it, nuqush, or it's a thawb, mulawwan. It's a thawb that is colored. It is a cloth that is colored. Nonetheless, the Prophet entered her house, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she had this qiram. And he told her, Amiti anni, فَإِنَّهُ لَا تَزَالُ تَصَوِّرُهُ تَعْرِدُ لِي فِي صَلَاتِي. This hadith is collected by Abu Dawood and others. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, remove it. Azili, the meaning of it is. Amiti, get rid of this thing from me. Because surely the pictures on it, the pictures on this curtain, distracts me in my prayers. So we find, brothers and sisters in Islam, that it is an important part of developing khushu' that when we go to pray, that we don't have these elaborately colored rugs and carpets, that we don't use images, that we try to remove all of those things that are going to divert us from the remembrance of Allah. For surely as Allah Ta'ala, as He says in His book, in Surah Taha, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, establish the prayer for my remembrance. Establish the prayer for my remembrance. How can we have khushu' thinking about Allah when we have images on a rug? And some people have made an innovation on top of the innovation by taking a special rug and placing it for the imam. A special rug on top of the rug you already have in the masjid. And these rugs have pictures of the Kaaba and pictures of the Prophet's masjid and pictures of the masjid in Quds. These things are distraction to the Muslim when they praise. How can we have khushu' looking at some of these things when our face, our eyes are supposed to be where we make the sajda, as we mentioned in weeks past? How can we be thinking about Allah when some of these images have the so-called Star of David, which is the symbol of Judaism? When you look at them, you see these stars that represent Judaism on the prayer rug. وَلِعَذُ بِاللَّهِ. So these are things the Prophet got rid of. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time he was praying in a piece of cloth called a khamisa. He was praying in a khamisa and it distracted him. It is a piece of clothing that has images on it. Tatriz wa a'lam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Izhabu bihadhihi al-khamisa ila Jahm ibn Hudhayfa." وَأْتُونِي بِأَنْبِجَانِيَّةِ فَإِنَّهَا أَلْهَتْنِي آنِتًا فِي صَلَاتِي. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, take this khamisa from me. This is not khamisa with a qaf. This is khamisa with a kha. Take this khamisa away from me and give it to Jahm ibn Hudhayfa. And bring me an ambijaniya, a piece of material, a piece of clothing that has no images. Has no images. And this piece of clothing that the Prophet had on had stripes, circles, and squares, as some people say. So this means that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in his prayers, the thing that he had on, the thing that he was wearing was distracting him from the remembrance of Allah. So he said, get rid of this thing from me and give it to Jahm ibn Hudhayfa. Come back to me with the Ambijaniya, for surely this thing previously was distracting me in my prayers. So we find, brothers and sisters in Islam, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the one who had more khushu' than any human being, and if we don't believe this, something is wrong with our iman, he was concerned about the environment that he was praying in, and he was also concerned about the very clothes that he had on. How could you consider yourself having khushu' praying with a t-shirt on that has the picture of one of these rappers, or a picture of a basketball player, or some kind of funny designs that distract you and others from the remembrance of Allah? وَلِيَعَذُ بِاللَّهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was very concerned, even to the point that we know that the prayers are obligatory in the masjid for the men 5 times a day, even to the point that when the food is brought to you, you're supposed to stay there and eat the food so that the feeling of wanting to eat will not distract you from the remembrance of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِذَا وُضِعَ عَشَاءُكُمْ أَوْ عَشَاءَ أَحَدِكُمْ وَأَقِيمَتِ الصَّلَاةُ فَلْيَبْدَأُوا بِالْعَشَاءِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when the food is brought to you, when it's made present, and the salah is established, then begin with the meal. Begin with the meal. وَلَا يَعْجَلَنَّا حَتَّى يَفْرُغَى مِنْهُ. He said, and don't rush in eating that meal. Stay there until you're finished. Even the salah itself can be delayed. You're not supposed to rush to the salah when the food is prepared for you. When the food is ready, then you're supposed to eat that meal, whether it is Maghrib, Fajr, Isha, Dhuhr, or Asr, as some of the scholars of Islam have mentioned to us. And in addition to this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has told us, in producing khushu' in our salah, that when any one of you has the desire to go to relieve him or herself, إِذَا أَرَادَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْخَلَاءِ فَلْيَذْهَبَ الْخَلَاءِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that when any of you has a desire to relieve himself by urinating or defecating, then he should go and urinate and defecate first. And he should not go to the salah. He should not go to the salah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he has explained to us that even when the person has the call of nature, and the person goes to the salah with the need to urinate or defecate to relieve themselves, that they should first go relieve themselves and not go to the salah. The person who is haqin, is the person who has to go to the bathroom to urinate. This is the person who's trying to restrain themselves from urinating. And the person who is haqib is the person who is trying to restrain themselves from defecating. When you have these two situations, you're supposed to go and relieve yourself firstly, because the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is paramount. And nothing whatsoever should keep you from thinking about Allah and producing khushu' in your salah. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. If we can come closer, brothers, inshallah, come closer. Inshallah, can you come closer, brothers, or the brothers in the back, inshallah, can get some room. Barakallahu feekum. الحمد لله رب العالمين ونصلي ونسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحابته أجمعين أما بعد. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has explained to us the importance of khushu, as we've been talking about from the weeks past. And this aspect of khushu, and this specific aspect of khushu' and producing it, or that which damages it, is extremely important. Even to the point that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has told us, and the meaning of the hadith is, that when the food is cooking on the stove, cover the pot so that you won't be distracted by the very smell of the food. To show us the importance of khushu', that when your wives are cooking in the kitchen, that you should cover the pots. And if you can, the meaning of it is, close the door to the kitchen if you have one, and get far away from the smell of the food, because this will be something that will distract you from the remembrance of Allah, because shaitan, using the food that's halal, will come and whisper to you and remind you of those potatoes and those plantains and that curry chicken. It will distract you from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the halal. Through the halal. Because one of the biggest tricks of shaitan is to use the halal to distract you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Turn off the radios. Turn off the TVs. Get rid of those things that are going to distract you. And in addition to this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has explained to us that when any of you has fatigue or he's falling asleep, when any of you is not sound, when any of you is sleepy or you become tired, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا نَعَسَ أَحَدُكُمْ, when any of you become sleepy, فَلْيَرْقُدْ فَلْيَرْقُدْ, he said, then you should lie down. You should lie down. فَلْيَنَمْ, in another narration, and go to sleep. حَتَّى يَعْرِفُ or حَتَّى يَعْلِمَ مَا يَقُولُ, until he knows what he's saying. Until he knows what he's saying. And this is in line with the ayah of the Quran, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى, do not go to the salah when you are befogged of mind. Do not go to the salah when you are befogged of mind. Either meaning you are very sleepy, or meaning you're intoxicated, of which we know this ayah was abrogated. In other words, brothers and sisters in Islam, when you are real tired, you should get some rest so that you can properly recite the Quran the way it should be recited, and you can remember Allah the way He should be remembered. Not like the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Zainab, when the Prophet came into the masjid one day, and he saw a rope between the two pillars tied. He said, مَا هَذَا الْحَبْلُ, what is this rope tied between the two pillars? They said, this rope is for Zainab. She uses it so she can stay up when she's making salah, when she makes these long prayers. She uses it to support herself. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, حَلُّهُ, unloosen it, untie it. That when any of you becomes tired, let him take rest. When any of you wants to pray like this, like Zainab wanted to pray, then let them take rest until they're able to know what they're saying. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those people who have khushu' in their prayers. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those people who are mindful of our prayers, and those people who remove those things that are going to distract us from the remembrance of Allah. And remove the clothing that's going to distract us from the remembrance of Allah. And that we are mindful of those people who are praying around us, that we're not laughing loudly in the house of Allah, and we're not joking a lot in the house of Allah, and we're not screaming out in the house of Allah, we're not talking loudly in the house of Allah, that we don't allow our children to run around when people are trying to pray to Allah in the houses of Allah, for surely these things will damage our khushu', these things will take us away from the remembrance of Allah. And anything that is away from the remembrance of Allah is an agreement, is in consonant, and an aid to a shaytan. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْهُ. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَّسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِن قَبْلِنَا. ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به, واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا, أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.